Hi everyone, I hope you are as excited as I am because React has released a new version. React 17 is still the current stable version. Nevertheless, React has released the new features powered by their new Concurrent render. So let's analyze them together. In today's video, we are going to cover three main points. How to upgrade to React 18, what's new, we are going to dive deep into what Concurrent render is, and four new features and one announcement they made, and finally, we are going to cover how hard it is to update our app with React 18 and how long it will take us. If you are starting a project, you can install it by using npm install react and react-dom, or if you are using yarn, yarn at react-react-dom. Otherwise, you can upgrade it to the latest version of React by doing install react at 18 and react-dom at 18. Once we install it, we will get a warning message in the console like this. React-dom render is no longer supported in React 18. Use create root instead. Until you switch to the new API, your app will behave as it is running React 17. This means the code will work, but we won't be able to use the 18th version until we do some changes. We need to keep in mind that React 17 is still the current stable version. Right, so we just need to switch from react-dom.render to create root, and then we call root.render. This is a new method to create a root to render or a mount. According to React documentation, we also need to remove the callback from render since it usually does not have the expected result when using suspense. We'll talk about suspense later. So this is before. And now we create a function where we return the app and this is what we pass to root.render. Finally, if your app uses server-side rendering with hydration, upgrade hydrate to hydrate root. We now import it from React DOM client and we pass our main app div to hydrate root. And unlike with create root, we don't need a separate root.render call here. We might also see another warning message when working with the unit test for the first time after updating to React 18. The current testing environment is not configured to support ACT. To fix this, we need to set in our test setup file global this is React ACT environment to true before running your tests. We also need to update our types to the latest version if we use TypeScript. The new types are safer and catch issues that used to be ignored. For example, now we need to define the props for children. What's new in React 18? The first thing that we need to talk about is Concurrent render. Concurrent rendering is a new opting in mechanism to improve performance. It's only enabled when we use a concurrent features, so there are no significant out-of-the-box breaking changes to component behavior. If we go to React documentation, React tells us that concurrency is not a feature. It's a new behind-the-scenes mechanism that enables React to prepare multiple versions of your UI at the same time. So to put it simply, concurrency unlocks new features for us. To do this, React evaluates the entire tree and then performs DOM mutations. React simultaneously prepares multiple UI versions in the background without blocking the main thread. React doesn't render our app synchronously. It can't be interrupted and change the order of the elements that are rendered. So it might start rendering an update, pause in the middle and then continue later. The user won't even be aware of this because the UI will seem consistent. And as soon as the priority changes, for example, suppose the user wants to interact with the filters, in that case, React will immediately focus on that new task and continue with the other slow or large task behind the scene. So we improve the performance and the perceived performance by delaying some state updates, creating a fluid user experience. The main takeaway about how this works is that Concurrent render allows us to focus on what we want to do, what experience we want to provide to the user, and React is scared of how to deliver that experience. Suspense on the server. To understand how suspense on the server works, first, however, we need to understand the difference between rendering a website using the client side or the server side. If you are unsure how client-side process works and the difference between both renderings, leave me a comment and I'll make a video. At this point, I'm going to assume you have some idea about it and we are going to focus on how this new feature works on the server. Let's recall how the process of rendering something on the server is. We fetch the data and then we render all the React components to HTML. So the first thing the user sees is the HTML structure and content, but the user cannot interact with it just yet. Meanwhile, we will load the JavaScript for these components on the client and connect all the logic to the HTML render in the browser. It is at this point that the page becomes interactive. This is called hydrate. This can be a bit confusing, so let's repeat it. First, the server sends the HTML to the browser. This gets rendered. The browser downloads the JavaScript and it connects the JavaScript with a static HTML generated on the server to make the page 100% interactive. Each step of the process will happen for the whole application all at once. Here is a dummy example of the different components our page needs to render. If we have one or more slow components, it could slow down our whole app and directly freeze it until the whole hydration process is completed. In this case, product is a slow component and is blocking my page from hydration. Maybe because it's making expensive API calls and it takes time for the data to come back, or we have lots of JavaScript codes to process in this component. So what we can do now is exclude the slow components from that initial page render and wrap each of them with suspense. Suspense is a component that allows us to split the code and show a temporary fallback component from the client until the slow component code is loaded. Then the server will render and show its HTML in the same streaming. For example, here I will show a loading spinner until the product's component is ready. I will also wrap personalized product suggestion with suspense because this is a slow component. So we can wrap multiple components with suspense. In this case, header, filter, and CTA sections will follow the normal process, loading HTML, loading JavaScript, and hydrating all at once as usual. The other two, products and personalized product suggestions, will go through their own asynchronous process in the order that they show up in the tree. Oh, but that's not all. React is really clever. If the user comes and click in this second block, personalize products, which is waiting to be hydrated once the product has finished, React will pause this hydration and start hydrating this one instead. That's because React knows that if the user clicks on it, means the user is more interested in having this content ready ASAP before the other one that was rendering previously. React prioritizes the part of the app the user finds more interesting. Let's wrap up. Before, React assumed everything was synchronous. Now with React, we can break the app apart into different blocks and allow them to render asynchronously when they are ready. Then React will prioritize the components the user clicks on them. So we no longer have to wait until all the JavaScript is 100% connected and is interactive. This solves the issue of a slow component holding up the process and improves the user experience by allowing the user to gradually consume the revealed content. Suspense is a powerful feature that helps us to let the user consume content faster and let them know that some other content is coming. However, the user still perceives the app with fewer visual changes as having loaded faster. So this means that if in your app you have loading spinners, the user will think that your app is slower than another app that doesn't have these visual elements. That's why React has also introduced new APIs. First, I should mention that these APIs will only be available if you have upgraded React and use the new root API as we did at the beginning of this video. This new root API enables the new Concurrent render and adds out-of-the-box improvements. Okay, let's quickly go through some of them. First, we have use transition and start transition. Transitions allow us to split a state update into an urgent and non-urgent part, the transition part. The way it works is React will interrupt the transition state updates and update the urgent updates first. We can use transition to tell React what parts of our code is not urgent and therefore has lower priority. So React will only execute it once the other actions are done. For example, if we have a filter component to filter down the products list, we can wrap the setState function with the hook useTransition to tell React to prioritize other operations over rendering the new products list. This means that the user can select an option from the filter dropdown. This component will be updated straight away. React won't need to block the browser from updating the dropdown and will then continue rendering the updated product list. This helps us to provide visual feedback to the user for an urgent update, so the user knows that the website is not broken, even if the list takes a bit longer to render. Transitions will help us to keep the app more responsive. Use deferred value works similarly, but it's mainly useful when we work with external libraries that we don't have control over the set state. Only kicks in when the user has a bad internet connection. In the same way, let us postpone the render of a non-urgent part of the tree. React will delay the render until the first urgent render is reflected on the screen. The deferred render is interactable and doesn't block user input. React has also introduced a hook called UseID that we can use it to generate unique IDs on the client and the server. Really useful for component libraries that need unique IDs for accessibility. React also recommends any state management library to use UseSync External Store to make it easier for them to integrate their library with React. I'm putting together a video where I will dive deep into how some of these new APIs work. From what I have seen so far, I think use transition and use deferred value are my favorites. So please hit the subscribe button and ring the bell to don't miss my next video. Today we talk a lot about new features that React has introduced to improve the performance out of the box. But not only that, React is thinking in the future. One of the features that they want to introduce in the next version is to being able to remove a section of the UI while keeping the state, especially in these components that get rendered conditionally. That's why from this version, the React 18, they are laying the groundwork. This is going to be really beneficial for components that render conditional, as I said, like if we have tabs. At the moment, every time we unmount a component, the state of that component gets lost. The only way to prevent this is by using state management libraries like Redux or using the useContext or higher order components. So what React wants is to give us a way where, instead of completely unmounting these components, we could just hide them and preserve the state. Unmounting and remounting trees using the same component state as before. So this will work in this way. React will intentionally render the component twice by mounting it, unmounting it, unmounting it again to prevent unsafe side effects. So in this version, React already simulates this mounting and unmounting, but only in this development mode. So this is how it works. React mounts the component. Layout effects are created and effect effects are created. Then React simulates unmounting the component by calling a cleanup function inside useEffect or component will unmount. Layout effects are destroyed. Effects are destroyed. Then React simulates mounting the component with the previous state by calling useEffect or component did mount. So layout effect setup code runs, effect setup code runs. What automatic batching is? Automatic batching is already available in React, but it just works in some situations. but joins multiple set state calls into only one update to improve the performance. This means that if we have set functions more than once, like we do here, it only updates at the end of the function. So it will go through each of them, and only when it reaches the end will update it. This is better for performance because it avoids multiple re-renders. If we check React documentation, we can find this. Currently, React 16 and earlier, only updates inside React event handlers are batched by default. Batch updating also works within use effect. The idea behind this is that we don't have to worry if we have more than one set state call inside a React event handler or synchronous lifecycle method. Instead, React will bundle this into a single render for us. But separate state updates were not batched in asynchronous functions such as async await, then cat, setTimeout, fetch, and so on. The way this worked up until now is that React will take this function and render the first set state, set name, and then go to the next one and render the set email, and so with all set functions that we have here, set address and set birthday. All of this is done behind the scenes. Right, so now with React 18, we have this functionality across all types of functions. This works everywhere. It doesn't matter where we update the function. So before, it was present in all the event handler and use effect. Now, automatic batching also works in all the asynchronous functions. Inside of promises, set amount, or any other event is batched by default. If we want to render the set state synchronously and disable the automatic batching, we can use the API flash sync. So not only do they introduce a performance improvement, but they also allow us to have the previous behavior for those components that need it. Now is the time for the big announcement. So from the 15th of June this year, 2022, React will stop supporting IE. I think this is a tricky one, not sure if I'm thrilled or not. On the one hand, many people, believe it or not, still use Internet Explorer, so if your client uses it, you still have to maintain it. And this will mean that you will have to stay with React 17. But on the other hand, it's good to see React decided to stop supporting it in this new version, because that'll make it easier for other companies to do the same. As it's getting harder and harder to make your code, your website, work with the same experience as it would in other browsers. Now that we have upgraded our app to React 18 and we have talked about the new features, I think it's time for us to talk about how long it will actually take us to migrate our app to React 18 and how hard this would be. According to React, it shouldn't require too much effort to migrate your app to React 18. Their strategy is to get the application up and running on React 18 without breaking existing code, and then, little by little, start adding concurrent features. So we will be able to migrate our app without too much effort, without needing to rewrite our components. Even if we use a library not compatible with React 18, we can still upgrade to this version and gradually use concurrent features. If your app doesn't work after upgrading to React 18, the first thing you need to check is whether it's wrapped in strict mode, because it got stricter. It could be the case that some log issues that were showing as warning before React 18 now are errors that break your code. So you can turn off this feature and solve the problem later on. A strict mode won't catch everything, but it helps prevent common mistakes. Thank you, everyone. Please don't forget to subscribe and ring the bell to be notified when my next video comes out. Also, leave me a comment in the description box below with your feedback. Let me know what you think about these new features that React 18 has just released. And hit the like button for the algorithm. Thank you.